College of Arts and Letters of the University of the Philippines, Diliman, and the Jimenez Gallery Foundation. To officially begin, may I ask everybody to stand for the singing of the national anthem.
ADRIÁN E. Foundation sa mamumuno ni Celine student. Dr. Michael Corosa, Pangulo ng Bill, at Senator Laila Maestalio de Lima. Magandang hapon sa inyong lahat. Good afternoon. Sa ngalan ng UP Diliman at ng Kolehiyo ng Arte at Literatura, malugod ko kayong tinatanggap dito sa Jimenez Gallery para sa napakahalagang ADRIÁN CRISTÓBAL Lecture Series para sa taong ito. Mahalaga, hindi dahil leap year ngayon o sabi nga ng mga sabuan mo ay malungsong katuwik o leap year. Kundi nagdiriwang ang Universidad ng Pilipinas ng Diamond Jubilee sa paglipat ng UP Diliman noong 1949 mula sa Padre Power. So, 75 years na. Pero isa pang importante ay dahil sa pag-imbita ng union ng mga manunulat sa Pilipinas sa ating tagapagsalita sa panayam na ito. Ang paglaban at paglaya ni Senador de Lima ay patunay lamang na kaya natin at may magagawa pa ang boses ng mamamayan. Pinapakinggan pa rin naman pagkamat walang kaniyakan sa mga susunod na paghiling ng sambayanan. Ang subalit, ang UPIL, ang ADRIÁN CRISTÓBAL Foundation, maging ang Kolehiyo ng Arte at Literatura, ay patuloy na lilikha ng mga tagpuang tulad ng ganito upang maipahayag ang ating saloobin sa iba't ibang issue at pagtuloy ng mga simulang magbibigay daya sa panulat, kumikilala sa karapatan ng lahat ng kasarian at nagtatanggol sa opresyong politikal. Bukas ang galeriya at ang IBG Theater sa kabila upang pagdausan o pagtanghalan ng mga panayam at iba't ibang anyo ng sining sa panahon kung saan nagsisiksikan tayo sa espasyong hatid ng social media. Ibalik natin ang tradisyonal na espasyo kulad ng entablado, galeriya, teatro, kanyer, lansangan at panulat. Nagwagi na tayo dati rito, kaya naman panahon na para muli magbalik sa mga panayam na tulad nito. Galingan natin sa susunod tulad ng panayam mamaya ni Senator Laila de Lima. Kasama ang buong pamayanan ng KAL at ng buong Diliman, maraming salamat. Salamat na marahay. Diyos mabalos. Thank you very much.
Diyos mabalos magtabi sa iyo, Dean. The annual ADRIÁN E. CRISTÓBAL Lecture Series was established by the CRISTÓBAL family in collaboration with the Union ng mga manunulat sa Pilipinas. To take us through what the event is about, its aims, and a snapshot of its history, may we call on Ms. Selina CRISTÓBAL, representative of the CRISTÓBAL Family Foundation and former UPIL board member.
Good afternoon, National Artist Mary Camaro, our guest speaker, former Justice Laila de Lima, Chairman of UPIL, of course, Michael Rosa, my brother, my family, Che, Nina, my daughter, Aaron's in the back with David. And also with us, we have the former Ambassador Jimmy Ampao. And good afternoon, everyone. Okay, I would like to give a history of the lecture series because I've been doing it for 30 years. And the upshot, if you look at the video maybe after the lecture, it shows you all the past lectures, very distinguished. In fact, we've had three national artists as our lecturers in this service. So based in New York, and she enthralled us with her lecture. And she was followed by Sheila Coronel, who finally was able to give a lecture because she's based also in New York, teaching at Columbia University. She was followed by my dear friend and journalist, Nina Espina Corona, and both of them gave personal accounts of their political lives during martial law and how their families were intertwined with the regime then. It was very, very moving, very personal. I think the video is available online. And now our last face-to-face lecture was by former Associate Justice of the Supreme Court, Justice Antonio Carpio. And now our first face-to-face after the pandemic is former Secretary of Justice of the Philippines, LEILA DE LIMA. It seems serendipitous that if we are to talk about or call for justice, it has to be face to face or something to be done. And so I'm very, very grateful. My family is very grateful that Ms. De Lima accepted our invitation. And we are also grateful to all of you who attended today. This makes I'm sure to be ADRIÁN very happy that you honored him with your presence. Thank you very much. Enjoy the lecture.
Thank you.
daughter of the late Commission on Elections Commissioner Vicente B. de Lima and Norma E. Maestrado. She has two sons, Israel and Vincent Joshua, and two grandchildren, Brandon and Hannah. She was educated by the Augustinian nuns of La Consolacion Academy and graduated valedictorian in high school. She finished Bachelor of Arts in History and Political Science at De La Salle University and took her law studies at San Pedro College, graduating as class salutatorian and Code of Kalamshaw awardee. She placed 8th in the 1985 bar examinations. Leila de Lima is a Filipino lawyer and activist, one of the staunchest voices in the Philippine human rights and justice cause. On her first time running for public office, she was elected senator in 2016. She immediately launched an inquiry into the administration's war on drugs, which has left thousands dead. For this, de Lima has been recognized as one of the leading global thinkers for standing up to an extremist leader. Prior to her election into the Senate, she served as chair of the Commission on Human Rights from 2008 to 2010, where she led a team of young lawyers and human rights activists in investigating extrajudicial killings and forced disappearances and all forms of human rights violations throughout the country. As Secretary of the Department of Justice from 2010 to 2015, our esteemed lecturer resolved high-profile cases, including the prosecution of several prominent figures linked in the misuse of public funds, the mass murder of media workers in Mindanao, and the dangerous raids of the prison cells from maximum security inmates, subsequently exposing and ending their luxurious lifestyle. She was also part of the government's legal team that received a favorable ruling over the Philippines' case against China's maritime claims on the Permanent Court of Arbitration in The Hague. It was also under her watch as head of an interagency council against trafficking that the Philippines was removed from the U.S. human trafficking watch list, paving the way for its long hoped for upgrade to Tier 1 status. Like her late father, Leila de Lima also made strides as one of the most prominent election lawyers in the country, handling high-profile cases of electoral fraud for national and local candidates, and always in her law career and later in public service, upholding the values of integrity, honesty, and competence that were instilled in her. As Senator Leila worked toward making meaningful policy and structural reforms in laws intended to improve the country's criminal justice system, promote human rights, strengthen the rule of law, and fight graft and corruption. In February 2017, for her outspoken criticism of the Duterte government's so-called war on drugs, she was incarcerated on politically motivated charges and unjustly suffered 7 years in prison on charges that were never proven or heard in any court of law. She remained strong and resolute in the face of great tribulation, a great model for all of us who have struggled against all injustice and all forms of oppression. We are very fortunate to have her here today to deliver the 2024 ADRIÁN E. CRISTÓBAL Lecture on the topic Gender and Political Oppression. Friends, let us all welcome Attorney Leila de Lima.
Thank you. you so much, Mabalos Jasmine, for that very comprehensive intro. The sun is still up there, so high up there. Magandang hapon po sa ating lahat. Pagkilala muna sa pamilya Cristobal, kay National Artist Rufino Almario, UMPL Chair Michael Rosa, and UMPL Vice Chair Susan Lara. Yes, please.
Thank you.
So, pagkilala rin po kay Timuel Nabao and former Ambassador Julia Mao and our guests this afternoon. Allow me please to reintroduce myself. I am Leila de Lima, former chairperson of the Commission on Human Rights, former Secretary of Justice, former Senator of the Republic, a lawyer by profession, a sister, a daughter, a mother, and a grandmother. They also called me a drug queen, mother of drug lords, an immoral woman, among many other names and labels. The daughter molded into principal by the public service by her lawyer father is also the most vilified woman in Duterte's time. Maraming maraming salamat po sa Union ng Manunulatong Pilipinas at sa Pamilya Cristobal sa pag-imita sa akin ang maging bahagi ng ADRIÁN E. Cristobal Lecture Series. This is such an honor. But when I received the invitation, I was rather hesitant. It has been a long time since I delivered the lecture, and I don't even want to call my discourse today as a lecture, just a message, just a sharing, just a conversation, especially in the caliber of previous ADRIÁN E. Cristobal lecturers. You all know them already, they were flashed on the screen, they were mentioned, parang mahirap po yata pantayan sila. I want to start by acknowledging that I'm not here as an expert, but rather as someone who has lived through experiences that have shaped my understanding of the topic into which we are about to tackle. I would rather call this sharing of perspectives, a conversation, if you will, on a topic that is deeply personal and yet resonates with countless women around the world, the intersection of gender and political oppression. But of course, during the open forum, I'm open to any questions from you, especially on the various political issues now. There are several of them. In fact, when I first thought on what topic to handle, I first thought of dwelling on topics like the Charter Change, the People's Initiative, the ICC investigation, the looming warrant of arrest, and then the seditious call of somebody calling for the secession of Mindanao and several other issues. But I settled with this subject matter, as being very personal to me, as a victim of a severe form of gender persecution. Ang pinakadala ko po ngayon ay ang aking karanasan bilang isang babae bilang buong politikal na nagbigay sa akin inspirasyon upang pag-aralan at pag-usapan ito ng higit na maraming. My own experience as a prisoner of conscience has provided me with first-hand insight into the complexities of this intercession. I have witnessed how gender stereotypes and societal expectations can be weaponized against women who dare to challenge the status quo. I have felt the weight of misogyny and sexism in the face of political dissent, and I have seen how women, particularly those from marginalized communities, endure the most of systemic injustices. Next month is International Women's Month, and even if there are not so many women here, I'm sure that we will be mulling over these insights of mine. But I have also seen how women come together to support each other, to amplify each other's voices, and to demand justice. I have seen the strength that comes from fighting together in the face of adversity. So while my personal story, like those of others, can offer a glimpse into the complexities of this issue, it is crucial to recognize that individual narratives represent only a fragment of the larger picture. This issue of gender and political oppression has taught me one of the greatest lessons I have learned in my almost 7 years of unjust detention, that we are all bound together in a shared struggle against systemic injustices that continue to persist. Dito ko lubos na naunawaan ang sinasabing sisters in the struggle. Thus, I would like to dedicate this conversation in honor of all the women who are our sisters in the struggle. Sa lahat ng kababaihan, pinipiling tumayo at ipagtanggol ang karapatan ng iba sa kabila ng kanilang sariling mabibigat na pasanin sa buhay. I met several of them. Some of them visited me during my incarceration. Some of them wrote me letters. I visited St. Mary's College of Quezon City recently to talk about politika at kasarian, pagsusulong ng pagkakapantay-pantay sa panahon ng patriarkal na lipunan. And I realized how challenging it is to discuss the issue of gender and oppression to young girls, young women, especially when faced with the temptation to offer simplistic messages of empowerment. I wish I could just tell them, kung ano kaya ng lalaki, kaya nyo rin. While of course it is an important part of the equation to defy expectations and demonstrate our competence and strength, alam mo natin hindi ganun kasimple. Sana ganun na lang. Addressing gender and oppression requires more than just offering platitudes about strength and resilience. We need to embrace a more nuanced approach to discussing gender and oppression with young women. It is through these conversations that we can continue to inspire meaningful change and empower the next generation of leaders and advocates. As someone who was raised to fight for my space like a man in a man's world, I was initially enamored with the idea that the struggle for justice transcends labels and identities. I remember in 2017, months after I was incarcerated, I wrote in a speech that, quote, as women, we should not allow ourselves to be silenced or cowed by misogynistic remarks. Unquote. This is not our fight alone, but a fight for our children and their future. Puro tapang, puro inspirational. Not realizing fully that for many women and their children, suffering in silence may be their only recourse and even relief. My experience, however, provided a harsh reality check. I came face to face with the stark realities of gender oppression and the unique challenges that women face in the pursuit of justice. During my almost 7 years of unjust detention, I had the honor of knowing the most courageous courageous individuals in the fight for truth and justice, mostly women who each had their own heavy burdens to carry, but never did once surrender the commitment to continue fighting for others. I learned from them that it is more than just defying expectations or demonstrating strength, but about confronting systemic injustices and challenging oppressive structures. They understood that addressing gender and oppression requires more than just individual acts of defiance. It demands collective action and systemic change. We often assume that a fight for justice transcends labels. But the reality is, as women, we navigate a world already shaped by societal expectations and power imbalance. These dynamics become even more pronounced when we step into the arena of political dissent. We become targets, not just for our ideas, but for who we are as a woman. We do not only experience being scrutinized for our ideas, but also the weaponization of our gender identity. Deliberate attempts to exploit existing gender stereotypes and societal norms to delegitimize our dissent and maintain the status quo. In my case, it was unmitigated misogyny. Suddenly, the issue was no longer the killings of thousands in Duterte's sham and murderous war on drugs, or even the merits of the drug cases, the drug trafficking cases against me, but the issue was my personal life. Ako bilang babae. But because of my persecution by a misogynist president, I was able to gain the support of women and women's organizations. We were able to show that in the struggle against a populist authoritarian regime, women were the first to stand up and fight to defend human rights and women's rights. The group hashtag Every Woman was born out of the misogynistic attacks against me. Suddenly, each and every woman wanted to claim that she was or she is Leila de Lima, every woman. Now I would like to talk first about si Leila de Lima, abogada, senador, nagawa nilang ipakulong kahit inosente, nakaranas ng injustisya sa lantaling pagkikipit at pagpapatahimik ng gobyerno. Ano ba kaya ang hindi nila kayang gawin sa karaniwang babae at mamamayan? That is always a question. Indeed, my experience as a senator being subjected to injustice and detention sends a powerful message about the vulnerabilities faced by women in positions of power. If someone with considerable influence and resources can be unfairly targeted and oppressed, what does that say about ordinary women who lack similar privileges? This raises important questions about the unequal treatment of individuals based on their social status, power and privilege, and challenges the notion that the fight for justice is universal. The belief in the universality, the equality in the fight for justice is something that most of us are raised to believe in, reflecting our aspirations for a fair and just society where everyone's rights and dignity are respected. But the notion of lahat pantay-pantay in the fight for justice is an idealistic concept that often proves elusive in practice. The concept of universality in the fight for justice asserts that fundamental rights and freedoms apply to all individuals, regardless of differences in nationality, ethnicity, gender, religion, or socioeconomic status. Similarly, the principle of equality in the fight for justice impartiality, and respect under the law. It asserts that no one should be subjected to discrimination, oppression, or injustice simply because of who they are or where they come from. There was a Universal Declaration of Human Rights, there is a Human Charter, there are several other international human rights instruments upholding and promoting these values. The reality, however, is far more complex. Naririnig ko din palagi yung kung hindi naman yan senador, dahil naman, hindi naman magiging ganyan ang atensyon na nakukuha niya. Totoo naman po yan. Indeed, the reality is that my experiences as a senator, being subjected to injustice and detention, garnered widespread attention precisely kasi nga nasa posisyon ako. Had I not held such a prominent role in society, it is likely that my plight would not have received the same level of visibility and support, both locally and internationally. The narrative that the fight for justice transcends labels and identities is a myth that needs to be critically examined. While it is true that the pursuit of justice should ideally be inclusive and universal, the reality is far more complex due to the entrenched systems of power and privilege that exist within societies. This narrative overlooks the significance of identities and labels in shaping individuals' experiences and access to justice. The marginalized often face intersecting forms of discrimination and oppression based on their identities. Furthermore, the idea that the fight for justice transcends labels and identities minimizes the unique struggles and experiences of marginalized, thus failing to address the root causes of inequality and injustice, which are deeply intertwined with systemic issues. This brings me to the concept of kung anong kaya ng lalaki, kaya rin ng babae, otherwise known as, sabi ng staff ko, lumaban ka na parang lalaki, fight it out like a man on one hand, and huwag kang lalaban, babae ka, on the other. I am particularly excited about this part kasi pinag-usapan namin ito ng mga staff ko. How two seemingly different notions of gender expectations. One that encourages women to succeed in male-dominated spaces, and one that discourages women to fight it out in male-dominated spaces. Both reinforce harmful gender norms and perpetuate inequality. Ako, I was raised to fight for my dreams like a man, knowing that as a woman, it would be particularly challenging to be recognized based on my own merits. Kailangan brusko ka, kailangan alpha ka, to survive. We are encouraged to adopt traits typically associated with masculinity, such as assertiveness, ambition, and competitiveness to excel. But when we start to challenge the status quo, we face backlash or be labeled as aggressive, bossy, or too ambitious. When the vilification and character assassinations against me started, ang komento ng mga tao, masyado kasing matapang, kalibanin ka naman si Duterte, na isang brusko. And I received more than 2,000 hate messages on my cell phone during that time. I had hundreds of bashers, receiving from them utterly offensive and at times unprintable words. We have Filipino women who succeed in all fields, but it remains a challenge for us to be recognized for our own merits, not for our sexuality. I think double-bind yata ang tawag dyan. When as women, especially women in politics, must navigate a narrow path, being perceived as too assertive Aggressive or ambitious traits, traditionally seen as masculine and therefore undesirable in women, on one hand, and not assertive or ambitious enough to be effective leaders, on the other. Both types of gender expectations contribute to the normalization of gender-based discrimination and oppression. They limit women's freedom to express themselves authentically and contribute to social progress without fear of judgment or reprisal. So how do we get out of the bind? You cannot get out of the bind by yourself. Tanging ang kolektibong pagkilos ang makakatulong sa atin na makalabas sa ganitong sitwasyon. Again, forgive me if I tend to say motherhood statements like this. But really, it is because of collective action that I am here now, rather than just through a written message from Kramen. Yun lang kasi ang ginagawa ko on all handwritten messages, communications to the outside world. Akala ko noon sapat na yung kinalakihan kong tapa, kung aking pagiging abogada, pagiging senador, upang harapin ng lahat ng pang-aabuso. I used to believe that my upbringing and my professional titles were enough to shield me from the abuses of power. But I have learned that true strength lies not in individual accolades, but in our ability to come together as a community and demand accountability for injustice. But again, something up. Easier said than done. Collective action must be rooted in recognizing and honoring the individual narratives and experiences of each person. It is not one size fits all. While the fight for justice ideally should be universal, it is essential to acknowledge that it does not transcend labels or identities in a simplistic way. Instead, it requires a nuanced understanding of how various intersecting identities shape individuals' experiences of injustice and oppression. Each of us brings our unique perspective to the table, informed by your personal histories, backgrounds, and struggles. And it is through the collective sharing of these diverse experiences that we can build a more inclusive and effective movement for change. So let me go back to how challenging it is to talk about gender and political oppression to the younger generations without falling into the trap of giving them inspirational but simplistic notions of their power within. I realized how effective and powerful it is to tell them through stories. Kaya ako hindi ako tumitigil sa pagkukwento ko sa mga speaking engagements ko. Alam ko naman na yun din ang gustong malaman ng mga nakikinig. Mainly about the 5x3 square meter of a detention cell, which was newly painted. The first time I saw it on February 24, 2017, when I was arrested. Or I also talk about my strict daily routine inside the PNP custodial center. My adopted stray cats, my plantita during the pandemic, the visits of the mothers and daughters who were orphaned by the drug war, even my harrowing ordeal with a hostage taker. We humanize the struggle. Statistics, while important, are not enough to capture the human dimension of injustice. Stories, on the other hand, put a face to the struggle. They allow us to connect with the individuals impacted by injustice and understand their experiences and feel their emotions. We challenge misconceptions and deeply ingrained biases through powerful narratives. By sharing our stories, individuals and communities can counter negative narratives often perpetrated by those in power. This helps expose the true nature of injustice and paves the way for more informed and compassionate responses. We build a community through shared experiences and a sense of belonging among those who have faced similar injustices. Hearing other stories can validate one's own experiences and inspire individuals to connect, support each other, and collectively advocate for change. Our stories also serve as vital historical records documenting the struggles and triumphs of those who fought for justice. By preserving these narratives, we ensure that future generations learn from the past, are inspired by the courage of those who came before them, and continue the fight for a more just and equitable world.
Mga manunulat po kayo ang karamihan sa inyo. Marami po ang ambag niyo sa bagay na ito.
To the unayin ng mga manunulat ng Pilipinas, please allow me this opportunity to thank you for sharing my story to the world, ensuring that they are not confined within the walls, the high walls of Karkramin. Thank you for your commitment to amplifying diverse voices and shedding light on the multifaceted nature of gender and political oppression.
Ang laking bagay para sa bawat individual na nakakaranas ng pamaapuso at injustisya na may nagtatawid ng kanilang kwento at nagpapanatili itong buhay na karanasan.
And ultimately, connecting these individual stories to the greater narrative of the struggle of our people against injustice.
Gusto ko pa sana magkwento, pero mas maganda mo sana sa open forum na lang tayo magkwentuhan. Kasi itong taon rin ako sa oras ng araw-araw, yung aking mga pagkausap, limited restrictions, limited visitation hours, or even my family, mas maraming pa tayong magkakataon kung magkwentuhan siguro later.
Before I end this talk, magtatampo ang staff ko if I don't leave you with this quote from Audre Lorde and Dow. Without community, quote, without community, there is no liberation. But community must not mean a shedding of our differences, nor the pathetic pretense that these differences do not exist, unquote. I would also leave you with one of my favorite quotes from Nelson Mandela, quote, "For to be free is not merely to cast off one's chains, but to live in a way that respects and enhances the freedom of others." End of quote. I'm truly honored to be part of this movement. And as I always say, you have all been given only one life to live, one country to love and defend, and one humanity that we all belong to and must respect and protect. And those are exactly what I will continue to do so for as long as I have breath, and how I hope my life so far and going forward will be defined. Live, love, defend, respect, and protect for life, for country, for humanity. Maraming maraming salamat po. Thank you for your patience. And,
ma'am, we will request you to please stay
Ma'am Jazz. Thank you po, former Senator Lima. Thank you very much for that very inspiring sharing of former Senator Lima. And now the floor is open for questions from the gallery, and we'll also entertain questions online. And Senator Lima, former Senator Lima, will try and answer all these questions. So, sa mga magtatanong po, meron tayong microphone doon, meron din po dito. Maybe just request you to please state your name and affiliation before you ask the question. So, meron na po tayo unang magtatanong.
Hello.
Hello.
I am Greg Peter Union, bahagi po ako na palihan ko rin ko si Katapas 15. Kanina po sinabi, narinig ko na birthday po pala ni Mr. Adrián Cristóbal de February 20. Pero yung sa akin po, kanina ko lang narinig yun, naisip ko na kaya February 20 ay dahil tinapat yun sa ngayong araw na whole day of social justice.
Exacto. So one of my core advocacies, aside from human rights, my main advocacy is human rights, intertwined with it is social justice.
Yes. Salamat po, yun lang po.
Ah, okay. That's a very good information. I also need to know about that. Salamat po.
Thank you very much.
International Day for Social Justice.
Organization called Gender and Development Advocates Filipinas or GENA Filipinas. Actually, the term is misogyny was also a Clary Robredo, as well as Maria Lourdes Sereno. So there were three victims of the term is misogyny during this time, and you were not the only one. But in spite of that, during that time, the left was sort of very comfortably working with the Duterte administration. And they were downplaying the fact of their gender, that it had something to do with your oppression during that time. So my question is, what can you say about this? And what is your relationship with the left?
Well, I'm comfortable with the left. Answering your last question, what's my relationship with the left? I coordinate with them. I coalesce with them on certain themes, on certain issues, especially when I was the chairperson of the Commission on Human Rights. They were my very active partners in advancing the cause for human rights. Unfortunately, at the height of the misogynistic attacks against me in 2017 and all the way up to 2019, only very few were speaking out. Even fellow women were more or less, they were afraid, they were scared of also coming out to my online events, including the leftist women. You know, the fear was there, and the realization that if that is being done to someone like LEILA DE LIMA, a high-placed government official, and then it's so easy for Mr. Duterte to target any other women, especially those in power. So they were also rather silent. In fact, the only group that was actively defending me was the hashtag Every Woman, and of course my colleagues in the Liberal Party and some youth leaders. But the left, as a organization, I hardly could hear any words of defense from them. So during those times, but later, they went back into being in solidarity with my causes.
Thank you, Bo. Yes, sir. Can you have a
question? Hi, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
My name is Omar Rahman. My question is can you tell us a little of the international support you got, if any?
Oh,
thank you.
I got a rather broad international support, and and I'm so extremely blessed by it. Many foreign organizations, Amnesty International, Human Rights Watch, several other international organizations, even foreign personalities and foreign institutions like parliaments, European Parliament, European Union, the United States Senator, they would occasionally issue release statements of support and calling for my immediate freedom. And it was such a great deal. It was such, you know, it meant a lot, because without international support, the persecution would have been worse. So, and in fact, at first, I was looking at, you know, I was thinking, how come domestically or locally, there were a few voices standing up, raising my causes or defending my causes. But the international organizations, especially the human rights organizations, were behind me from day one, and I'm so grateful for that. That helps a lot. And the government was conscious of that. And in fact, during the trial of my cases, I had three cases. Two had been dismissed already. I was acquitted already in two of the cases. And there is a third remaining case where I am out on bail for conditional liberty. And in most of those trials, hearings, some embassies would send their observers. So that also helped a lot. So the judges' concern were rather cautious that they needed to do the right thing. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Po. Before we entertain another question from the floor, question from our live streaming from novelist New York-based Ninoch Carrosca, who was also mentioned as one of the former lecturers.
She also wrote to me, so I say hi to her.
Okay, we'll she's watching, she heard that. So the question is, in what way and to what degree do gender-based attacks and calumnies impact the reception of ideas and propositions from a female engaged in politics?
Well, as I said, I can only talk about my experience. I am exhibit A of the gender-based oppression and persecution that I suffered from the Duterte regime. It had great impact, because it also silenced most of my women who matches at first, as I said. And then it also limited my means and ways to further advocate for gender or women empowerment, and also my duties as a senator. I could only perform my duties as a senator in a limited way. I could only file bills and resolutions. I could not participate in the deliberations or the debates, and let alone in the voting of important legislative measures. I had several bills on human rights, social justice, and even women empowerment, especially women, persons deprived of liberty, women deprived of liberty, but these were all ignored. So a lot of impact, it restricts you, it limits your ways and your means of furthering your causes. And in politics, I would want to see more of women leaders, especially in Congress, women lawmakers, that will truly and genuinely advance for women's causes. Those who are independent-minded and those who are strong-willed to fight for what is right in order to further the interests of our country, and particularly the women's causes.
Very much.
The gender oppression and the women's issue, in my mind, is also a men's issue.
Definitely, I agree with you, sir.
Yeah. What are two or three things that we men can do to help dismantle gender oppression?
Okay. Join us always in our advocacies. That's one. Number two is that be an example to persons close to you, to your loved ones, to your family, to your neighbors, your friends and colleagues. Be examples of men who respect the dignity of women, the capabilities of women. And number three, just don't stop advocating
pagbabalikan mula sa kolehiyo ng arkitektura at malalim mo sa katribu o kabataan para sa tribu Pilipino. Ang mabigat po no yung laban ng political prisoners, lalo na ngayon no, na mayroon ng anti-terror law. At para rin po no, sa maalaman ng lahat, maging sa aking kolehiyo, meron kaming estudyante, meron kaming kaklase na isang political prisoner. Siya ay isang babae at malakas siya at naninindigan rin no, para sa tama. Siya po si Amanda Jaris. Ang isa po sa tanong ko, no, ngayon po na vulnerable ang karamihan dahil sa mga batas no, na naroon na ngayon. At syempre, alam natin kung ano rebe na narito ngayon. Ano po yung mga epektibo pang hakbang na dapat namin mas gawin para ba mas malalistro yung kampanya no, para sa pagpapalaya ng marami pang bilanggong politika? Ayun no.
Maging aktibo lang po tayo sa mga advocacies, sa mga movements, sa pag-pursue ng mga karapatan ng mga political prisoners. I was also a political prisoner, specifically a prisoner of conscience, and I saw firsthand how collective support can do in terms of really furthering your own causes. And mag-ano lang tayo. Sama-sama lang tayo lagi. And then write about their stories, write about the stories of other victims of injustices, recognize firmly their own experiences, and share them with others, and move forward meaningful, let's say, legislative or policy reforms in government. It includes also electing the right people in government, right women leaders who would continue to advocate for the rights of women and also for political prisoners. Panawagan at dyan lagi, panawagan lagi tayo sa pagpapalaya at pagrespeto ng mga karapatan ng mga bilanggong politikal. Kulang pa yan. Pero sa ngayon, yan lang pwede natin magawa muna. You know, continued, persistent, and constant collective action and collective movements and struggles to fight for their rights. Yun po ang may ipapayo ko muna at this point. Yun naman talaga na ang ginagawa natin pag-insan-insan, pag meron tayong mga nakakatalirinig ng mga kaso, pero we also celebrate triumphs, for example, the recent issuance of the writ of amparo and writ of habeas data to the two environmental activists, si Jen Tamano and Janila Castro. Kasi bihirang pagkaroon ng writ of habeas data. Paminsan-minsan meron writ of amparo, pero yung writ of habeas data, that's the right to privacy of person. I actually filed a petition for writ of habeas data against then President Duterte, but it was dismissed by the Supreme Court on the sole ground of presidential immunity from suit, because he was still in power. Despite the argument of my lawyer, Dean Chel Jogno, that in my case, the presidential immunity from suit should never have been applied, because his tirades, his sexist, his misogynistic remarks about me were all beyond his work, his official capacity. Never had we seen a president, someone who holds the highest position in government, to embark, to engage in such highly deplorable actions, misogynistic actions against one woman. But unfortunately, the Supreme Court stood back to the decision that for as long as Mr. Duterte is in power, you could not sue him. So now that I am free, my lawyers are actually thinking of filing cases against him and his cohorts for their persecution. Dapat lang. Not for anything else. I don't want to be vindictive, that I'm not a vindictive person. It's just that, you know, it's a matter of justice. They cannot just do that. They have to realize that. They cannot just do that, particularly to one innocent woman. Yes.
Thank you very much for sharing that information. Are there other questions from the floor?
Hello. Good afternoon, Senator De Lima. I am Hannah Natotakola. I am with my blockmates from the UP College of Law. We went here because of our professor, Dean Tony Davidio. So nice to meet you.
Yes.
I have a question. It's two questions actually. But first is, at what point during your incarceration did you realize that your fight was a collective fight and it's just beyond being brave as an individual or a woman? And my second question is, if you can give an advice to us female law students, because law is such a male-dominated field. So how did you fare and what advice can you give us?
Okay, about my experience and about when I first realized that I was not alone. Actually, first year of my incarceration, late 2017 and up to 2019, or before the pandemic, there were several women, wives or sisters or daughters of victims of the drug war. They empathized with me and I empathized with them, and I saw their strength, understanding the fact that they were also suffering. And of course, some women leaders, some former colleagues of mine in the Pinoy administration, they were always there for me. And then I got a lot of letters and communications locally and also from abroad. Members of the Amnesty International, they launched the Amnesty International launched a campaign where men and women could send me letters of sympathy, letters of compassion, and I appreciated it so much. So early on, I was able to realize it. Although when I was at the height of my fight, before I was incarcerated, I thought that only few would be joining me. Now, what my advice to students, just excel in what you do. Your studies, law is such a formidable endeavor. Lots of readings, lots of, you have various sorts of professors, and you have to cram, and you have to read a lot of jurisprudence. Industry, hard work, excellence. You have to fully realize your potentials as women and eventually women lawyers.
I'm Gideon Bob. The weakness is in your case is we can't. Their testimonies and mention the officials who influence them into doing so. I came across a statement from Senator Drillon that those officials who influence you. Should be accountable. Have there been developments about these cases like that, those officials mentioned here in this?
Okay, so as I mentioned earlier, we intend to find cases against them. Now, we hope to strengthen our cases against him in light of the developments of his recantation of witnesses. About a couple of them had formally recanted. Now about eight or nine of them had written to the judge, signifying their intention to recant, that they were forced, they were coerced, their lives, their security, and the security of their families were being threatened. Then, when they were asked to testify against me, and that's why we asked for their transfer from their current place of confinement. They're not there in Mindoro Occidental, in Sablayan. So that's rather We wanted them back here at the New Believing Person for them to be able to really formalize the recantations so that they could be assisted by independent lawyers. But our motion is still pending with the court. Now we're waiting for that. We're waiting for these witnesses to formally submit their recantation of their previous false testimonies so that it will strengthen our cases against those responsible for my incarceration. And I want people to know the truth. I need them, I need those official recantations and other developments to for my vindication, because I am after vindication. So, wala pa po kami na i-file ang kaso kay Mr. Duterte, kay former Secretary Aguirre, and other personalities behind my persecution, but my lawyers were working on it. So that's the development.
Thank you, Paul. Are there other questions? Yes, ma'am.
I have two questions. One is, how did you survive the 7 years? And the second part is, what did you discover learn about yourself during that time?
Oh, these are wonderful questions. How did I survive? Sheer will, power, mind over matter. I was so conscious of the fact that the reason why I was incarcerated, because they intended to break me, they intended to destroy my spirit and to silence me. I was not about to give them the pleasure or the satisfaction of seeing me destroyed. From day one, I was very conscious of that. And that's the very reason why I had to develop a strict daily routine so I could really make myself busy and forget about, you know, feelings of a depression, of vindictiveness, of negativism. So I had to, from 4:30 in the morning when I wake up to about 10 or 11 in the evening, I had to make myself busy, both mentally and physically. I read a lot. I read the Bible. I prayed every day. I prayed the Holy Rosary. I was praying the Holy Rosary when I was held hostage in October 9, 2022. And then I do a lot of reflection. I also do physical chores. I had my own compound. I was isolated from the rest of the detainees of the PND custodial center. So I cleaned my own compound, my own detention quarters. Now I had to, of course, to bear with certain limitations because I had no TV, I had no radio, I had no shower, I had no aircon, I had no cell phone. Cell phones are contrabands, so I did not have any access to the internet for 6 years, 8 months, and 21 days, for a total of 2,454 days. So I had to content myself with just handwritten messages, communications to my family, written communications to my friends and relatives. I don't know if some of you have came across my dispatches. These are handwritten dispatches from Krame, my commentaries on burning issues of the day. That's all I could do. I had no cell phone. So I had to be very busy. I had to play with my stray cats. I had to adopt my stray cats. They meant a lot. They helped me keep my sanity intact. And I became, as I mentioned, I became also Kritika during the pandemic. So busy every day. And of course there are visitors, although visitations were limited, but it also helped a lot that on certain days visitors were allowed. So my lessons is, among my lessons would be that you would never know the extent of your own perseverance and your dedication to a cause unless you go through that kind of ordeal. I knew that I was already strong, but I didn't realize I still have something in me to make me stronger. because of the solitude, because of the isolation, high concrete walls. And during the pandemic, there was total lockdown for 4 months. Not a single visitor was allowed, not even my family, not even my lawyers, not even my spiritual advisors, except only for doctors when needed. You know, and all those restrictions. And I attempted for myself. I did everything, washing my own clothes. And then I would not accept the food in the detention center for safety reasons. So I had to wait for food coming from my house or from my relatives. And they would deliver to me food once in the morning only, because someone allowed breakfast, lunch, dinner. So I just had to repeat the food for lunch and dinner. So all those difficulties, it was a struggle, both mentally, physically, and also emotionally. But I had to fight it off, especially during the harrowing of this taking ordeal. I thought it was the end of me, but I had again to be strong to fight off any fear. And I did survive it, thanks to the Lord. So then, you see yourself as a victim, but the fighter in you should still be there.
Thank you. Very amazing sharing, Delila. Other questions? If you're still thinking, sabi nila privilege na may hawak na mic. You can also ask my question. So I think this opportunity. Napakaganda po nung sinabi niyo, Ma'am, about the power of narratives or stories. And now, yung pag-share niyo, yung po, ano, very, really affecting us and very powerful. Is there a plan in the near future to put all this together, your dispatches and other writing?
Yes, I intend to. Because aside from the written dispatches, the regular handwritten dispatches, na pinapadala mo sa labas, inibigay ko lang sa guard at inibigay sa syllabus. I also recorded on my day, on my journals, daily, from day one. I did not miss any day where I could write my reflections for the day, my experiences for the day, whatever it is, no matter how simple, I would write it in a journal. And my journal consists of parabinashang notebooks and nashang pass. Those are my daily reflections. Daily journals, so one of these days I intend to find time to concentrate on book.
If I can just share, I was able to read a couple of your dispatches from Warren, from the posts of Professor Waldo Bell.
Yes. As you know, Professor Waldo Bell would be my number one supplier of books. Every now and then, up to now, he would send me several books, but of course I could not read them all. And most of his books were serious stuffs. I tried to balance my readings from the light ones, and even romantic novels I would write, detective novels romantic and detective novels I would read, and then sometimes historical books. And courtesy of Professor Walter Mill.
Salamat po, ma'am. And I'm sure that's very good news for everyone here. We will wait for your book or books. I hope in the near future.
Thank you so much. Thank you for the honor of having me this afternoon. Thank you for having me.
Family of the
magkakaroon po tayo ng sertifiko para sa ating panahon, pero magsalita. Manggol na pinagkakaloob ng Union ng mga manunulat sa Pilipinas at ng ADRIÁN E. Foundation, itong katibayan ng pagpapahalaga kay kagalang-galang Leila de Lima dahil sa kanyang mataos na pagpapahagi ng mataas na kalungan karanasan bilang intelektual na pamadla at imbitadong tagapagsalita ng ADRIÁN E. Cristóbal Lecture 2024 na tumalakay sa paksang gender and political oppression. Ngayong ika-20 ng Pebrero, 2024 sa Jimenez Gallery ng Universidad ng Pilipinas, Dilaman. Nilagdaan po ng inyong lingkod, bilang tagapangulo ng UPIL at ni Selena Cristóbal, ang pinag-itawan ng pamilya Cristóbal. At papangitin po ni Selena. Magiging bahagi ng ikalimang volume nito. Salamat po.
Maraming salamat sa pagkulan ng UPIL at sa pamilya Cristóbal. Gusto po namin pag-usapan din ang ating kagalang-galang National Artist and Chairman Emeritus of UPIL, Sir Rio, the video of Mario.
Kawani ng UP, ng Cal, at ng Jimenez gallery at pamamagitan ko kasi ng isa-isa ni Kalin Clamor, Carmela Bascon, Eric Juanillo, Adrian Magtas, Jason Lagahin, Brian Lagsamana, Jamon Dragon, Ronnie Apuyon, Gillian Salas, Obet Marcelo, Roland Guerrero, Clarice Pascon, Paula Hanyo, Ray Gonzalez, Miguel Buno, Dean's Office Staff, ang IBG Cal, Theater Staff, Institute for Creative Writing. Maraming maraming salamat sa inyo. Napakahusay ang inyong pag-asikaso sa event na ito. Wala akong masabi. At siyempre, ang director ng Institute of Creative Writing na si Dr. Romulo Baquiran Jr. na nag-iwang lamang ng kanyang kaarawan ng nakaraang linggo. At sa inyo po na nagsikap na magpunta ngayong hapong ito at sa lahat ng mga nanood sa atin online, salamat sa live streaming na ginawa para mapanood tayo tulad ng dati, hindi lamang sa lugar na ito, kundi sa atang panig ng mundo. At kaya nakaabot pa ka sa atin ng tanong sa Minoch Carosa, salamat na naging ADRIÁN CRISTÓBAL Lecture din po natin. Paano mo po tatapusin o paano mo magbibigay ng pagwakas na pananalita sa okasyon ito na napakaganda ng karanasang ating narinig? Ibig ko pong magbahagi ng isang tula. Nasa tingin ko ay angkop na angkop sa sitwasyong dinalakay ng ating panahon. Ang pamagat po nito, mapagpalang na itig. At ipaubayan ko sa inyo kung sino ang pagkilala sa persona ng tulang ito. Sino kaya ang nagsasalita sa tulang ito? Sabi ni Sir kanina na nagtanong, o nagsabi niya, laban din ang lalaki ang usapin ito. At kaya nga po palagay ko, lalo dapat kumpig kasi ang tulang ito. Ang pamagat, mapagpalang na itin. Lalaki ako ngayon, nakikipagtikma sa nakamihas ng marahas na salita. Sa mahabang panahon, ikaw ang nasalanta ng bisyo't ambisyong pagpapakatakila. Ikaw man ang lupang nagluwal sa lahat, kaligtad kang iginaya sa maraming alamat na ang katulad kong di umano'y malakas ang ipinagbubunying bayaning tagapagligtas. Itinuturing ka mang pangarap na matayog, pilit inaabot sa hangad na masakop, at gawing sa isag ng giting at bantog, kahit pa ang ganda't tangal mo'y madurog. Pinagdududahan ang iyong pagkukuro, ikaw man ang sa lahat ay unang nagtuturo. Ipinagdidiin ang birtud mo ang pagsubo upang makapaghari ang ganit at palalo. Ang katotohanan ay matagal ko nang batid na hindi ka mahina gaya ng ikinikiit ng mga institusyong sa iyo'y nagsisilid sa kahon ng kahinginan at banal na likid. Lalaki ako ngayon, nagsisikap tumakas sa rehas ng laksang panuntunang ipatas. Hindi ka si maganda, hindi ako si malakas. Kapwa-tao tayo, walang mas nakaalan. Hindi ka si Eva, hindi ako si Adan. Ang pagkakasalay, hindi sa iyo lamang. Kapwa-tao tayo, may mga pagkukulang. Sa pag-ahon sa lusa, tayo'y magkatuwa. Lalaki ako ngayon, patawad ang hinihingi. Sa mahabang panahon, ang tulad ko'y nagkamali. Sa mahabang panahon, humastang hari na tinalimot ng tulad kong hindi ka pag-aari. Sapagkat ang totoo, ikaw ang nagluluwal sa lahat ng uri at maaari sa buhay. Kahit na ano pa ang ipagyabang kong tagumpay, ikaw ang siyang simulang hantungan. Ikaw ang mutya para lumang
pag-ibig. Ikaw ang walang maliw na bukal at pintig. Ikaw ang ina, kapatid, sinta, kapanalig. Ikaw ang babaeng mapagpalang daigdig. Maraming salamat po at sa ganyan maraming po ako sa iyan. At sana po ay makita-kita tayo muli sa susunod na ADRIÁN E. CRISTÓBAL Lecture. At yun po sa susunod ng taon, sana dito pa rin. Ang ganda rin po. Salamat po. At i-anunso po na ang ating pong ika-50 Writers Congress ng Union ng mga manunulat sa Pilipinas ay magaganap sa 27 ng April. Sana po, magkita-kita tayo lang doon. Napakahalaga po nito para sa umpil dahil ginigitlo po ito ika-50 taon ng Union ng mga manunulat sa Pilipinas. Sana dito. Maraming salamat po at salamat sa ating MC, Dr. Jasmine Laman. Okay, welcome back. Militante. Salamat po.
Maraming salamat. And this has been the 2024 ADRIÁN E. CRISTÓBAL Lecture. Mabuhay ka, Laila. Salamat po kayo ng hapon po sa